And I have the honor to introduce our next speaker, who was here until a second ago. He's here. So this is Joseph Sifakis from Lausanne and Grenoble, winner of the Turing Award, I think, in 2007 for verification of both software and hardware. And his title of the talk is a very universal, on the nature of computing. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you. Can I get my slides? Yes. Shall I do something to flip the? Yes, okay. I have to duplicate this. Otherwise, it will not work. Now it should work. Okay. Thank you. This is technology, yeah? Good morning, everybody. 2 years ago, I gave a talk here about the provocative title is Computing a Science. So this is somehow a continuation of my thoughts about computing. The motivations have not changed since then. Computing is a young discipline, and it does not enjoy the same prestige as natural sciences and mathematics. It's not hard to understand this. Also, I should say that I am interested in philosophy of science, and I'm a bit suffering because I think that physicists are dominating the scientific thought, and very often physicists ignore the importance of computing. They try to explain the world in terms of, as interaction of particles, they have this reductionist approach. I think it is useful, but has its limitations. And this is a sample of sentences pronounced by famous scientists. I let you contemplate this, in particular the last one, brain could exist outside body. This, you've seen probably this in newspapers. And I think such a sentence shows that some ignorance of what information is and how the brain works, at least, okay. Another motivation is that computing is a fast-evolving discipline and has changed over the years, changed names, and I think even among the computer science community, there is no agreement about the perimeter and the focus of the discipline. Although I think we all agree now that computing is no more about computers than astronomy is about telescopes, as Dijkstra was saying. My main message here is that computing is a great domain of knowledge, dealing with the study of information processing, both how what can be computed and how to compute it. So this is what I'm going to explain in this talk. And this is an outline of my talk. I'll try to clarify this concept of information that is very important, explain what is computing, and then to try to link computing to physics, or at least to classical physics, and to link natural and artificial intelligence, then finish with the discussion. Now, what is information? Information is just a mathematical relation between the syntax of a language and the semantics. And the semantics is defined by humans. It's a set of concepts. I hope you understand what semantics is. And to go from a semantic domain to a syntax, you need this representation function and then the denotation function to go backward. So a concept like the number 4 may have different representations. And of course, when you write an algorithm, this is a recipe that the computer executes by manipulating symbols. But the semantics is defined by the programmer. This is clear to me. And computers so far do not create information according to that definition. So the information is in the mind of the beholder somehow. If you take a script that has not been deciphered so far, this is no information. If we take a script in ancient Greek, this may be understood by this information for a Hellenist. Maxwell's laws make sense for a physicist, and if you have an apple, then this is information for everybody. So why I'm saying this? Because in many cases, even computer scientists do not understand that information is an entity different from matter and energy. It's non-material, although it needs media for its representation, and information is not subject to time-space constraints. So if you consider all the basic models, computation, Turing machines, automata, you don't have any concept of time there, okay? So it's just mathematics. And it is created by minds, not by machines, so far. This is something perhaps I will explain further later. So this is very important. Information is an entity different from matter and energy, so you need a discipline to study information processing phenomena. Also, another source of confusion is that sometimes this concept of information is confused with syntactic information, which measures the quantity of symbols needed to represent a message. So according to Shannon's theory, to take the most classic definition of syntactic information, characterize the content of a message. It is n log b if n is the number of the number of places, the length of the message, and b is the length is the number of the symbols of the alphabet. So, just to conclude, syntactic information is a useful concept, but it ignores meaning. And when I'm talking about information, I'm not talking about syntactic information. Should be clear. Now, what is computing? If you try to apply the standard definition of science, computing as it is today is not a science or has some aspects of science. So I'm not going to fight against definitions. According to standard definition of science, mathematics is not a science. Engineering, okay, has some relation to science, applied science. I think that a more useful and pertinent concept to talk about computing is to talk about domain of knowledge. And I should say here that computing also has revealed the importance of knowledge as a concept. So what is knowledge? Knowledge is information that you can use to understand the subject, to or to solve a problem. So this is this definition of knowledge encompasses scientific knowledge. And I think an important distinction is the one that Kant made first in philosophy, that knowledge is either a priori knowledge. So a priori knowledge is knowledge that is independent of experience, mathematics, logic, and most of the theory of computing that is based on mathematics is a priori knowledge. And this is absolute knowledge, modulo the validity of the axioms of the theory you are considering. On the contrary, a posteriori knowledge is scientific knowledge, is engineering knowledge, economics, cooking, whatever. And this depends on experience and empirical evidence. And I should emphasize here that a posteriori knowledge is come in degrees, so you can have in any case, it's falsifiable knowledge. You understand this? It's just a generalization of observation, a posteriori knowledge. So considering domains of knowledge avoids some sterile discussions about science and non-science. And also, I think it's a very useful concept because, okay, we get rid of this model that has been especially emphasized and promoted by physicists, that you start by some observations, you build some models, you try to explain, etc. I mean, the pursuit of knowledge is a process much more complex than that. So Knowledge acquisition involves the development of science and engineering. It's easy to understand what science is about, engineering is about, and what is important is the interaction between science and engineering. These are things very easy to understand. And okay, I would like to show this slide, which simply says that in order to understand the world, you should distinguish between the material world and the models of the material world, or the conceptual models of the world, and this is information. So what's the role of science? The role of science is to conceptualize, to try to understand the laws, and formalize possibly the knowledge. So knowledge is information that may be used and reused in a context. You understand this. And engineering goes in the opposite way. So science goes from, say, the earth to the heaven, and engineering goes from heaven to the earth. Okay, you know things, and you try to apply them. So scientists build experiments in order to study, and engineers build study in order to build. I hope you understand these are very simple ideas, but I hope this clarify the it's very important to understand what will follow, at least. Now, what is computing? Computing is a domain of knowledge that is distinct from physics and biology. I said this. It has both scientific aspects. So science is deals with the study of information processes, both artificial and natural, and in particular now natural processes. And of course, there may be many engineering disciplines related to computing. For instance, you may have real-time systems engineering, knowledge-based engineering, information systems engineering, things like that. Okay, now let's get to more serious things. What are the fundamental domains of knowledge? Of course, mathematics is standing behind everything and is providing the models to understand the world. And then you have physics, of course. Physics so is about understanding the world and building artifacts. Computing is to study information processing phenomena and to build computers. And then you have biology. So biology deals with phenomena where you have where the physico-chemical aspects are very tightly related. It cannot be dissociated from computational aspects. And this is the reason I consider that is a basic domain of knowledge. Now, I think that all domains of knowledge share some paradigms that are common to fight against complexity and scale problems. So you know that physical world is has depth and breadth. Physical phenomena are studied in scales from the Max Planck length to the size of the observed universe. So in order to understand the world, we are using abstractions. So what is abstraction? Abstraction is a holistic view of some phenomena where you try to reveal relevant features. And so abstraction is finding the right abstraction is not an easy task. And Dijkstra was rightly saying that being abstract is something profoundly different from being vague. The purpose of abstraction is not to be vague, but to create a new semantic level in which one can be absolutely precise. Okay, so what do we do to understand the world? We define abstraction hierarchies. So we have layers or models that can be interrelated through abstraction relations. And here this is a personal attempt to show a decomposition, a layer decomposition of what I call physical hierarchy, computing hierarchy, and bio hierarchy, perhaps. You don't agree with that, but I think such a decomposition is possible, that is applied or should be applied in practice. And of course, the challenge here is how you can relate the different layers of models and eventually to have something like the theory of everything as physicists dream of. Okay. Now, complementary principle, simplification principle is modularity, as you know. So modularity is useful because you assume that the what we are observing is composed of atoms, of components, of bricks that you can glue to build more composite systems. And here you rely, in fact, in three assumptions. The first assumption is that the behavior of each component can be studied separately, and then you can compose components, the behavior of components, to get the behavior of composite components. And an implicit assumption is that the behavior of components, when you compose them, is not altered. And this is, okay, this is true for classical physics, and this is the reason this principle of modularity was a great success in classical physics. But in some other areas of knowledge, this is not true, for instance, in biological systems or in linguistic systems. And here I would like to mention a specific problem for computing systems that is called, by computer scientists, component heterogeneity. While, for instance, for hardware, we can build chips from a limited number of types of components, memory, buses, arithmetic and logical units. We have no common component model for software, and this is a key limitation to mastering the component-based development of software, and this may explain also what some people call the software crisis. Okay, now an important question that has been the object of long debates, particularly in the philosophy of science, is whether by combining this hierarchical decomposition principle and modularity, we can unify knowledge. So, for instance, knowing the properties of components at one layer, we can infer global properties of composite components at higher layer. So is it possible to infer properties of water from properties of atoms of hydrogen and oxygen by applying some compositional rules? I've discussed this question with physicists who said that this may be theoretically possible, but this is too complex. And I think the same holds for the other question. Inferring the properties of an application software that runs on a hardware platform, if we understand how the hardware behaves as an electrical circuit. And I think these questions are show that there are some limitations in deriving, I mean, unifying knowledge across layers. And this was rightly pointed out by Phil Anderson in a famous paper, More is Different, published in Science in 72. He says the ability to reduce everything to simple fundamental laws does not imply the ability to start from those laws and reconstruct the universe. I hope you don't disagree with that. Now, another interesting also question is how our ability to compute or use computers helps with creating new knowledge or building artifacts. And this has to do with concepts that I call predictability. So predictability has to do with the ability to study a system and create new knowledge. And designability is the dual concept. You start from requirements and you build an artifact. So when you say you are a scientist, you want to study complex phenomena, the first thing to do is to create a model of the phenomenon and validate this model. So I want to study complex phenomena like predicting earthquakes or meteorological forecast. So I'll build a model, try to validate it, And once I have a model, I'm convinced it's a good model, faithful meaning that whatever I holds for the model holds for reality, then I will try to analyze it, and we'll be using computer for this. So predictability is maybe hard because of the fact that what we call epistemic complexity, so the phenomenon is intrinsically complex, you try to study, and you may have also computational complexity. And usually now, if you start from requirements, so you want to build a complex system, you have to understand the requirements written in natural language, then you have to come up with a formal model. So here you are facing another kind of complexity that I call linguistic complexity. You have to validate it. So engineers are playing scenarios, have validation techniques for that. And once you have such a model, then you have to solve a synthesis problem, and this is a mathematically well understood problem, and you are facing another type of complexity that is computational complexity. So designability depends on linguistic complexity and computational complexity. Okay, now just to show an example of time predictability that illustrates this idea of predictability in computer systems engineering. So if you are, building a real-time systems, you are interested in estimating best case and worst case execution times of programs. And you probably know that the behavior of hardware or the execution of a program on a sophisticated hardware platform is non-deterministic. So you have such a distribution of execution times. And worst case and best case show the bounds of the variation of execution time. So this is what happens in reality. Now, when you try to model the dynamic behavior of a software running on the platform, then you are making some abstractions. I'm not going to explain this, but you are making some very drastic abstractions. So in the model, you have some lower bound and upper bound, and then you have to analyze the model, and you are using techniques, and these techniques cannot compute the exact bounds. Why? Because they are not computable, so you are taking some approximations, so you have estimated. Okay, so you see the combination, so the time predictability depends on how well you can model the system and how well you can analyze it, and this is something very important in systems engineering. Now, I would like to discuss two things that are important, how physicality can be linked to computation, and then the connection between artificial and natural intelligence. So I think that today everybody agrees on the fact that, okay, phenomena are driven, of course, by laws, but also they have some informational content, and there are some keywords like computational thinking, digital physics that express this idea. I would like to get it a bit deeper and discuss these differences. So I'm trying to compare computing systems with systems in classical physics. So you deal with systems that can be described by equations of this form, expand function of x and y. X is the current state, y is the current input. So for physics, you would have x prime will be derivative, and the variables are function of time. And for computing, you have some similarities. X prime is next state, and I hope you understand this. So if I have a simple physical system here, I will describe the dynamics using a differential equation, and then you have a law that is the law of conservation of energy, and the computational model. Okay, you write a program, so the program through its operational semantics describes the dynamics, and you have laws, and the law is what computer scientists call invariant. So invariants in programs play the same role as the laws in physics, the big difference being that the laws in computing systems are created by their designers, And also a very, very important difference is that the variables are a function of time here, and while in computer you have just discrete variables. And this is a very, very important difference between computing systems and physical systems. Because physical systems are intrinsically parallel and synchronous, one problem is modular simulation of physical systems when you try now to build complex, what we call cyber-physical systems. And this problem has been identified already by Richard Feynman in a paper on simulating physics with computers that he published in the Journal of Theoretical Physics in 82. He says that the rule of simulation I would like to have is that the number of computer elements required to simulate a large physical system is only proportional to the space-time volume of the physical system. I don't want to have an explosion. And the risk of explosion comes from the fact that the system, the physical systems are intrinsically synchronous. So this article has been pointed out by a physicist when I was working on this problem I call modular simulation. So you know that engineers build very complex models of artifacts like, say, aircraft, cars, and the problem is how to have a modular way to and distributed to way to simulate them. So each physical component uses a solver that is on a computer, and you would like that each physical connector be a protocol that will involve the connected components. If you want to agree with the idea of Feynman also. And just to give you a very concrete example of it, so if you have, for instance, a circuit, you write the differential equations that characterize the dynamics of the components and then the constraints induced by the connectors. So most tools today compile all of these equations into a global model and then try to solve it, to solve the system of equations in a centralized manner. So the idea will be that each component of the circuit here, L, C, and R, is simulated by a program, PC, PR, PL, and then we have protocols to coordinate. And this idea, I don't think that this is practically doable with a reasonable overhead. This is a very interesting problem to study anyway. Another problem you have when you want to translate, to link physical systems with computers is that time, of course, is dense. So within a time interval, you may have many, many changes, an infinite number of changes, and this cannot be modeled by finite, by using finite memory. Here I'm showing the example of a unit delay. So a unit delay is a very simple mathematical function. If you try to translate, to give an automaton that is something, exhibits equivalent behavior, you can do that only under the assumption that the input does not change here more than one time per time unit. Then another problem you have when you try to simulate or to study by using computers physical systems is what people call Zeno behavior. Is the phenomenon to have an infinite sequence of converging events. So if, just to give a very simple example, if I take a ball and leave the ball from an altitude H and at each shock, the ball loses some percentage of its energy. So here you see that I'm assuming that the speed after a shock is reduced by 20% of the speed before the shock. You get a So the ball should eventually stop, but there is no simulator, a discrete simulator that can achieve this. Okay, I hope you understand this. And detecting, proving non-zeroness is an undecidable problem because you have to apply induction to do this. And there are other problems that have to do with time predictability. As I said, time is not a notion that is built in computing systems. All the models of computation do not have a concept of time. So if you, and of course software is untimed. So when you want to study the dynamic properties of a software running on a platform, then you have to add state variables that will model the progress of time. And you have to be very careful about that because the programmer is the master of time. So you may introduce inconsistencies by doing that. And another problem also, very well-known problem when you try to analyze these time systems is what people call timing anomalies. Timing anomalies is a phenomenon where performance degradation, we have performance degradation if you run a software on a faster platform. So I have a software, real-time software, it is okay, fine, and then I charge, I run it on a faster computer, and I may have problems. So this is because the explanation of this is due to the fact that you have non-determinism, some hidden non-determinism in the software. Now, let me finish by talking about the relationship between artificial and natural intelligence. I know there will be a panel this afternoon, but this is just a few thoughts. Of course, artificial intelligence is an old story. The term was has been coined by Turing, and this is a discipline that had ups and downs. And recently you have a gain of interest because of the success of deep learning. So you have also an exaggeration in hype and speculations. You've probably seen all this in the media. I think that this is simply non-substantiated, and I think the computing community should react to that. More seriously, computers surpass human thinking in that they compute much faster and with extremely higher precision, and this confers them the ability to win in games. So you've probably seen this, and you've heard about the recent success of AlphaGo. For me, this is not a sign of intelligence. I think that because here we are comparing just behaviors, and you know that Turing's test has been criticized all of this. You have a criterion that is purely behavioral. I'm not going to explain what the Turing test is about. It has been criticized by very valuable criticisms by Searle, who developed this Chinese room argument and shows that intelligence means understanding. And also the test may be diverted in many different ways. And also, I think that logically, I cannot infer that if a computer passes the Turing test that is more intelligent than a human, I will say that it has been programmed by a genius programmer. That's all I can conclude logically. Now, I think a key issue here is how we develop systems that exhibit general intelligence, so not specialized intelligence to win champions or to drive cars, but behave like humans, have some adaptive behavior. This is a very deep problem. I think we should understand how humans reason, and it's elementary to say that humans build a semantic model of the external world that is progressively built along their lifespan. And what is consciousness? Consciousness is the ability to see the self acting in this, interacting with the semantic model and evaluating the consequences, weighing the consequences of your decisions. So we need to build such, to equip computers with such a semantic model. And okay, now this means that we have to analyze natural language and okay, create semantic networks and all this stuff. I have worked for years on analyzing natural language specifications or requirements for systems, and I think that very little progress has been accomplished so far. And the humans are much superior to computers in using common sense. You've probably seen this. So a very smart robot may do this silly thing. And if you want also to test your system, you can take something like that. So here you have a sequence of frames. Humans can easily understand that it's about a crash of an aircraft. If you show this to a computer, he will probably understand that you have an aircraft and the bus moving, but understand that the aircraft is about to crash. This will need to provide to make explicit a lot of information to the computer and for the computer to be able to handle it efficiently. Now, another limitation of computers is that, and we should be aware of that, is that as a consequence of Gödel's incompleteness theorem, computers cannot discover induction hypothesis, because if they could, then we can prove that programs are correct or programs terminate. So this is another limitation you should be aware of. Just to finish on a less pessimistic note, I would like to say that if we want computers to become more intelligent, then we should explore another avenue, and this is called the natural computing. So natural computing relies on the computational capability of physical processes, and it is robust and parallel. So robust means that small changes have a commensurable effect. And I suspect that it does not suffer from limitations of the Turing-based computing. This needs to be proved. There are very interesting questions, and recently, and these questions have to do with the foundations of physics. And recently, I've seen a paper published at MIT review that is cited here. Okay, now I think I should conclude. Yes, I would like to point out another interesting discuss another interesting remark about how the human mind works. Okay, probably I've seen this book by Daniel Kahneman, Thinking Fast and Slow. So he says that the human mind combines slow conscious thinking and fast automated thinking. And I think that computers are well suited for modeling slow thinking. And in fact, mathematics and logic reflect the way our conscious thinking works. So probably there is something else to explore, and this is related to natural computing. Okay, so let me try to conclude to leave some time for questions. So computing is a distinct domain of knowledge. I have emphasized the need for computing to be enriched with physicality and also to connect with artificial intelligence to physical intelligence. Nonetheless, as you understand this, as an aircraft is not a bird, a computer is not a mind, so there is a lot to be done for computers to reach the intelligence of minds. Also, I think that computing has revealed the importance of design as a problem-solving activity. And I think that design is becoming today something very, very important, and that providing design with rigorous foundations is is an endeavor that is really important, as important as creating scientific knowledge. And I think I stop on that to leave some time for questions. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for a nice and challenging talk. I'm sure indeed we'll have some questions or comments by the audience.
Yes, Vincent.
There's somebody young in the back.
First of all, thank you for your talk. So I was wondering, you, when you had these concerns about this artificial intelligence, I was wondering, you said computer science should react to that. In what sense did you mean that?
Okay, just to explain, I'm shocked by the campaigns in the media saying that taking seriously all these arguments about artificial intelligence being a threat to humanity without any comment, any doubt, okay? This is taken by the media, and okay, I think this is... I mean, it's very dangerous what they are doing, these guys. Because also this, by doing this, they hide some other dangers that come from the use of computers, and humans are responsible for that, not computers. Technology is neutral. Technology is neutral. It depends on it's humans use it in the way they like or they decide to do, okay? And computers act as they are instructed to do, fortunately. Okay.
The other thing I observed was that we haven't heard very many female voices this morning. I hope we can change that too.
Well, yeah.
Can I?
I'm okay. Sorry, I'm okay. Not a female voice. I had raised my hand beforehand, but surely, sorry for that. Related to this question of technique being neutral, I would like to focus in what you said about semantic models and the need to build semantic models. Mm-hmm. So what I see in computing is this ability to build a semantic model that can be explored by everybody. And it looks like kind of it has been under used when you look around, because you see a lot of syntactical, you would see a lot of artists and they will show you all their pictures, mm-hmm. right? But then there's no usage of computing as a way to express the deepness of the concepts in a way that everybody can really be amazed. And thank you for your talk, it was inspiring.
Yes, so just a short comment. I think that this is a real problem. Analyzing, understanding the natural language, and even subsets of the natural language. I have worked for years on analyzing requirements for aircraft, for instance, or satellite systems. And it's very, very hard to come up with a formal framework to talk about properties of these systems. Very, very difficult, okay? So I have no reasons to be optimist about this possibility to formalize a natural language. Perhaps we should explore other avenues. But I'm not really optimistic. I cannot be optimistic. And whatever I've seen on ontologies is really, I mean, very weak. Is very weak.
You mentioned Mr. Kahneman at the end.
Yes.
And the idea of the slow and the fast thinking. Something that is fast thinking is automated. So therefore, we don't have to think about it, we just do it.
Yes. When you are talking, you are thinking fast. Yes.
Yeah. I could imagine that a system could also be fast thinking if it's trained and maybe hardwired so that it runs automatically. Yes. And the software is the slow-wired system of the computer. So that could be realized, I think, the slow and the fast thinking in a system.
Yes, but I think fast thinking is really parallel. And as it happens in our mind, I mean, in our brain is analog, basically, okay? And if you compare bandwidths, okay, 90%, more than 90% of our intelligence, 95% of that comes from fast thinking, okay? I believe that the model, the appropriate model for fast thinking is really something that will be analog computing, okay? Some kind of natural computing that is intrinsically parallel, okay, as physical, as natural computers, okay?
So
I cannot imagine, or we have machines, yeah. We have hardware that yeah. can simulate this, yes. So you get rid of the von Neumann model, mm. but we've been talking long time about that, and this is not possible, apparently. Nobody has proposed anything else. And the very deep reason is that programming is sequential, and the logic is sequential, and consciousness is to some extent sequential and causal, okay? So there are very deep reasons. The reasons comes to the nature of logic and the nature of computation as it comes from, I mean, Turing-based computation, whatever it means, okay? So we cannot cope with that.
And what
you should find another type of model that is intrinsically parallel and fast, okay? Or information flows.
Yeah, parallel computing.
Yes, yes. Yeah. So kind of data flow model. But you know also that we've tried to build data flow computers and we have not been successful at that. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, there are other questions.
Okay, the very first question, I'm just standing here. For this talk came from Windsurf, and we have let them wait for quite a while.
So thank you. I just think of one thing, and it has to do with model building. I'm beginning to think that natural intelligence is very much revolving around the ability to create a model.
Yeah.
I'm thinking even of an example. If you learn to ride a bicycle, at the beginning you think about it,
yes.
and you don't do it very well,
yes.
and eventually something happens, and you have a model that allows you to balance, but you don't think about how you're doing it. So model building may lie at the heart of intelligence, natural intelligence.
May I interrupt you? Okay, so this is an interesting example. And this has to do with the interaction between fast thinking and slow thinking. So when you are a baby, okay, you learn how to speak. So you say, pa, whatever, okay? So this is conscious effort. And then you feed the automated reasoning, okay, that is fast reasoning. When you learn how to ride a bike, okay, you make a conscious effort and then this becomes automated. And some faculties, if they are not acquired automatically by some age, then you cannot do that, okay? But this construction of the model for riding a bike is not conscious, and that's the problem. I think that logic reflects conscious reasoning. We will have a lot of difficulty to understand how, okay, our mind builds the models that are used by the fast thinking machine just because it's automated, okay?
I see many more questions raised here. Okay, resist.
Thank you for a nice talk. What are your prognoses for next decade? Which cyber-physical models will be realized?
Sorry, can you repeat which?
Cyber-physical models will be realized.
Sorry, I'm not sure I get the question.
Yes, it's working. Which cyber-physical models will be realized
For cyber-physical systems. So if people
yes.
understand what are cyber-physical systems are, these are smart systems that where we have put computing power everywhere and we have integration of cyber-physical components. So what you need is differential equations with discrete events. If you know a language like Modelica, for instance, okay. But the use of these languages poses a lot of theoretical problems because you have to mix continuous systems and discrete events. And this is, I mean, we can talk offline about the difficulties. We'll deal with that, okay?
I mean that I understand that the problem is hard, but which problems are now are in under investigation and you think that it will be solved?
Okay, I can give you a long list, but I have mentioned some ones like, say, modular simulation, okay? Detecting Zeno behavior, detecting timing anomalies and things like that. I think there was a question.
Yeah, I have to congratulate you that you raised many more questions than we can handle here.
Okay.
I would like to have one last question here, yes, from the... Yes.
Thank you again for the inspiring talk. I just want to... So in the beginning of the talk, you were talking about the essence of computing. And we saw that, so there is various challenges when you have the knowledge and the real world, and you have modeling with epistemic complexity, verification, synthesis, and then you move to the physical world, where of cyber-physical world, where people kind of either elicit physical laws or create laws, and then you move to the artificial intelligence. So where do you see that, so this artificial intelligence or computation would contribute in the first schema with, where complexity is everywhere in modeling and synthesis and in verification? And do you think that also machine can create laws or discover some extra laws of physics,
okay,
or create laws?
Yes, that's a good question. So machines creating knowledge, that's the last question. So of course, machines can create knowledge as I defined it, with the difference, of course, that there is a risk we don't understand. So we may not understand how why it works, why. So we can have predictability without understanding. And you have very interesting results in that. Yes, machines can create knowledge, and this is perhaps, if there is a danger, this is a potential danger, that machines can predict, I don't know, earthquakes, but you don't understand why, okay? So it's science, so prediction without understanding, okay? This is a new kind of science or knowledge, yes.
Okay. Thank you very much for your interesting, inspiring talk. I thank all of you for your interesting questions. Apologies to those. I think we have to go to the coffee break now, and there's more opportunity to discuss informally. Thank you.
Thank you.